you please sit down? We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. So we're here today to remember our dear friend Dorothy before God, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, to commit her body to be cremated, and to comfort one another in our grief. Now, Dorothy was born in Whitwood between Normanton and Castleford back in November 1932. She went to Whitwood Primary and then she passed her 11 and plus and went to Normanton Girls High School. She was athletic as a teenager, loved running and netball. And she had an adventurous streak, which meant that when she decided on a nursing career, she, instead of training locally, went all the way up to Durham to the nursing school there. And on one occasion, won Nurse of the Year award. Now, nearer to home, she'd met Tom, who himself trained as a nurse, and they married in the mid-1950s. They set up home in Sheffield, where Dorothy nursed at Fox's, which was a steel factory. They moved around quite a lot in those early years, including a spell in a big old people's home in Keithley, where Tom was assistant superintendent and Dorothy was assistant matron. And the residents really loved her sense of humour. And then came the big move to Bridlington, where they took the post as superintendent and matron, respectively, for the Red Cross Holiday Home in Belgrave Road, just a few yards from here. And they were there for 20 or 30 years, and that's where Angela and Christine grew up, of course. And this Red Cross home was a sort of home from home for invalids, as I suppose they're called in those days. Their carers could stay there too if they liked, or just have some time away if they preferred. No more than 14 people at a time, so very much a family feel to the place. Of course, it was long hours, as it is in that type of work even today. They just had every other weekend off, but she and Tom loved that way of life and were much loved in return. Now, Dorothy was rather ahead of her time. She was an advocate for the rights of disabled people. So when she pushed wheelchairs around Woolies or Marks and Spencer, then if the shop staff tried to speak to her, she'd say, no, you know, talk to the patient, the person in the chair. She'd always make sure that her guests could get their hair done, and there was always a party night during everyone's stay. At Christmas times, the house was closed to disabled guests, and extended family came instead, lots of aunts and uncles, and there was a big celebration. Everyone dressed up. Christmas Eve, everyone came here, or rather the old church before this one was here, for midnight mass, and then they'd all go back and stand under the lamppost by the rose garden outside the house and sing carols, which I hope the neighbours appreciated rather than otherwise. But there's no one here to contradict me, so I'm going to say they absolutely loved it. Well, I ought to set at the beginning not only a warm welcome to all of you here in church, but those of you joining us at home watching either live on the live stream or catching up later, particularly those over in America and other far-flung places. The wonders of technology means that we can all be together today. In this short service, we're going to say a little bit more about Dorothy. She's given strict instructions on the hymns that we are to sing, so we'll do that. We'll say some prayers, we'll hear some words from the Bible, and we'll end by commending her to God's safe keeping. First, would you bow your heads and join with me in this opening prayer? Almighty God, you judge us with infinite mercy and justice, and you love everything you have made. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven. Through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, our first hymn is Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, and so would you please stand. Like to sit down, please. So the Bible reading that's been chosen is one of Dorothy's favourite passages of Scripture, Psalm 23, the Lord's my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He shall refresh my soul and guide me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup shall be full. Surely goodness and loving mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Many years ago, my wife and I were walking in the Lake District, and we were coming down a hillside, and there spread out before us was a valley and a flock of sheep. And there was a shepherd on one of those quad bikes, and way in the distance there was a collie dog, a sheep dog, rounding the sheep up, and you could just about hear the shepherd shouting instructions. And the dogs were pricking its ears up and moving one way or the other. And I said knowledgeably to Celia, "Oh well, they use a special dialect. I think I read it somewhere it sort of passed on from father to son. It's big in this part of the world, and it's sort of how the shepherd communicates with the sheep." Anyway, we got a bit nearer, and we realised that far from being a special dialect, this shepherd was yelling at the dog in what you might call broad Anglo-Saxon, which I won't repeat. But that's how modern-day shepherds are, aren't they? There's a fair amount of yelling. The dog does a lot of the work, and it's marvellous to watch, isn't it? These rather stupid creatures get herded up and moved into one place. That's not how it was in the ancient Near East, at the time that King David was writing, "The Lord's my shepherd, I shall not want." Although there are many of us, I think, who think of God rather like that, distant, yelling instructions, and us having to sort of get into line or our legs get nipped. Wasn't like that at all. Smaller flocks, and the shepherd, rather than being behind them, was in front of them and was leading them from place to place. Because in that part of the world, then as now, rain is in slightly short supply, so actually when a patch of grass is nibbled dry, you'd lead your flock to a new place where there would be some nice green pasture. And that was King David's job before he was a king. When he was just a boy, he was the shepherd boy for the family flocks, and used to have to sort of fight off wild animals with his short staff, and he would have to care for the sheep and lead them. And I suppose it was in that long experience he realised that's actually how God treats us. The Lord is my shepherd, and he leads me, and he makes me lie down in green pastures. And then it's as though he protects us from evil using the rod and the staff. So the rod, I think, was a sort of short club, so you'd fend off wild animals. And then the staff was one of those shepherd's crooks with a hook on, which you can drag the sheep out of danger or out of brambles where it had got stuck. So it's a very intimate and lovely picture of how God leads us. He guides us, doesn't he, in our lives at close quarters, saying, "Don't go this way, go this way." And we, being silly sheep, say, "Oh no, that way looks much nicer." But of course, the shepherd knows that actually the decent pasture is over here. And he protects us from evil. Sometimes the flock has to be led through perhaps a narrow ravine to get to where it needs to go, where the sun goes in and it's all a bit dark and dangerous. It's what the psalm calls the valley of the shadow of death. I suppose it's that valley that we're all treading through at the moment as we remember Dorothy, isn't it? But again, David's assurance, the Lord leads us through the valley of the shadow of death, and we need fear no evil, for you are with me, Lord. Your rod and your staff comfort and protect me. So again, this lovely picture of God, close quarters, protection, leading, even and perhaps especially in the difficult times. The last couple of verses of the psalm, the metaphor changes entirely, and we've left behind the shepherd and the flock, and we now have an image of a banquet. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, which is honoured guests would get this, an anointing with oil. My cup shall be full. Surely goodness and loving mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So again, it's a lovely picture, isn't it, of feasting, of togetherness, of plenty. The anointing is a picture of blessing. Jesus often used this idea of a feast or a banquet as a picture of heaven, and which I just love, as someone who enjoys cake and getting together and laughter. I think that sounds really good. And Jesus himself said, you know, don't worry, I'm going ahead of you. Don't be troubled and upset. I've gone to prepare a place for you, you know, somewhere to live, shining up the cutlery maybe, I don't know. So there we have this wonderful picture of God caring for us. And it's one that Dorothy knew as well, of course. Maybe that's why she loved this psalm. Caring for us at close quarters, protecting us, leading us through all the sort of changes and chances of life, with this feast waiting for us. So if we're God's friends, if we've actually said yes to Jesus, then we will be welcome to his banquet where he is the guest of honour, and we are just treated as honoured guests, anointed with plenty and with feasting, and which goes on forever. Well, Dorothy's race is run. Her journey is now at an end. She is with the Good Shepherd. But we've still got a few yards or miles or who knows how long we have left. So one day our turn will come, though. Are we ready? Are we already in Christ's flock? Are we being led by him or by our own selfish desires? Can we truly say the Lord is my shepherd? Because that's what David was able to say, and it's what Dorothy was able to say, and I pray it's what we can say as well. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. Well, it's time to say a little bit more about Dorothy now before we come on to our prayers. So we sort of left her, as it were, with Tom running the Red Cross home, but eventually, of course, she did retire. But couldn't sit around doing nothing, so she manned the seafront first aid post for quite a while, so sorting out people's jellyfish stings and no doubt sunburn on the odd day when the sun does shine, and so on. Her claim to fame is that for a while she nursed David Hockney's mum. I think that's pretty cool, David Hockney, the artist, as you know. She had lots of involvement in the church here. She loved to sing, and so she was once part of an extended choir that sang for the Songs of Praise over in York. She's pretty proud of doing that. She was part of the mothers' group here, always good for making teas after a service on a Sunday. And she was also a really good neighbour. She was great with her hands, of course. She loved to crochet, made clothes for herself and for her daughters, which I don't know if they've forgiven her for, great with needlecraft as well. She never lost that youthful sense of adventure. There was plenty of travel in later life, over to the States, of course, but also Hong Kong, Malaysia, New Zealand, Australia, and various parts of Europe, in the US, even going sledging. Dorothy was someone who was a little shy, wasn't she, but always caring and giving. I, of course, only knew her in later life, when her mobility was already poor, and then visiting her at the Waynes, of course. But I was struck by someone who, with a strong sense of right and wrong, and could tell she was a force to be reckoned with back in the day. I know that staff that knew her in her earlier life and whom she trained always spoke very highly of the training that they received. She gave a really good start to them. She always encouraged people's independence as well, which is quite a knack, isn't it, when you're caring for a lot of people with a lot of needs. She loved her Yorkshire Terriers, Trixie and Tiny, and also Christine's dog, Ollie. And of course, more than that, she loved her family. And proud to be a great-grandma twice to Owen and Rhys. And she visited as much as possible, despite the distances between them all. Her last words to them were, "Goodbye, I love you," which is a pretty good way to end, isn't it? So I'm going to say some prayers now. If you'd like to make the prayers your own, just join in with the Amen at the end of each one, won't you? First of all, there's a prayer that thanks God for Dorothy and her long life. Father of all, by whose mercy and grace your saints remain in everlasting light and peace, we remember with thanksgiving Dorothy, whom we love but see no longer. And we pray that in her your perfect will may be fulfilled. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Second, a prayer for those who mourn. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn. Especially now we pray for Angela and Hugh, for Geraint, Melissa and Owen and Evan, for Christine, for Declan, Shari and Rhys, Devon and Jeff and Mackenzie. And we pray for the wider family, for all her friends and neighbours and carers and everyone who will miss her. We pray that, casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A funeral is a good time to ask for God's forgiveness for ways in which we failed him and each other, and this next prayer is an opportunity to do just that. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We turn from the wrong that we thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we failed to do. For the sake of Jesus who died for us, forgive us for all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. And a prayer that reminds us that one day our turn will come to die. Lord, teach us so to number our days that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Help us by your grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to remember the needs of others, to serve and help those in trouble, and so to live that we may not be afraid to die. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we end our prayers with the words that Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, in just a moment, we'll sing our second and final hymn, and then we'll remain standing while we commend Dorothy to God's safekeeping. And then we're all invited to go straight over into the cafe area, where there'll be some drinks and some cakes and all sorts of nice things, chance to meet each other and have a few more reminiscences about Dorothy. There's some lovely photos out there as well. On your way out, you'll spot a carefully positioned bowl by the double doors. If you wish to put an offering there, the family have kindly said it is for the work of the church. We'd be very grateful. And we will be remembering you, as we have been in our prayers over the next few days. So would you please stand, and we're going to sing Love Divine, or Love's Excelling. Let us commend Dorothy to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer. By your power, Jesus conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of Christ's victory and claiming his promises, we entrust Dorothy to your mercy in the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you now and forever. Amen. We have entrusted Dorothy to God's mercy, and we now commit her body to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our frail bodies to be like his glorious body, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To him be glory forever. Amen. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes. The busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so may God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.